evening. Thank you very much for being here tonight. This is going to be a very, very important election for the office of sheriff. There's a lot of complicated issues that are coming up and need to be dealt with. My name is Tim Saxon, and I do want to be your next sheriff. I have over 30 years of law enforcement experience, about 28 years with the California Highway Patrol, where I've worked patrol divisions. I've worked the streets in Los Angeles and Oakland. I was promoted up from the ranks of officer, sergeant, lieutenant, captain. My last command was the captain of the Hollister-Yearwood area. And while I was there, I was responsible for all of San Benito County for traffic-related operations there in the southern part of Santa Clara County. After I retired from the Highway Patrol, I went to work for the Trinity Superior Court as a marshal. And there I've been working for 5 years. I do front security, I do bailiff operations within the courtroom, transport prisoners on occasion, do evictions, and also serve civil papers. And some of my experience with my career, other than working road patrol, where I was adding it up the other day, and I probably, in the area of issuing about 8,000 citations and arrested about 500 people, mostly for DUI. Other than that, I went on to work background investigations, recruitment. I was the commercial vehicle enforcement coordinator for all of Southern Division, which is Los Angeles. I trained allied agencies such as the Sheriff's Department, LAPD, Long Beach, Santa Monica, in how to effectively enforce commercial vehicle laws. I worked in Sacramento as the department's recruitment coordinator for all classifications in the state. I also taught at the CHP Academy, sexual harassment and sex discrimination prevention. I promoted to lieutenant, went to San Jose, worked in Oakland as well. And there I was a field operations officer responsible for up to 90 employees at a time. Went back to headquarters, and I worked in the Office of Special Projects. There I ran the department's grant program. At the time, we were managing about $45 million in grants. I was responsible, my unit and I, for writing the grants, and I personally made presentations to the Office of Traffic Safety with regard to the Highway Safety Plan for the department. And these are funds that come in from the federal government. Those programs have to be managed appropriately, and the money spent properly and reported back to the government. I also worked at the state capitol. I was the liaison to the governor's policy council on alcohol and drug abuse, and the Office of Criminal Justice Planning, and the Juvenile Justice Committee. Excuse me. I left there and went up to Weaverville. I became the commander there in 1998. So I ran CHP operations in Trinity County from 98 to 2007. I went on to our division office in Redding, where I coordinated all the administrative functions for the 17 areas north of Sacramento to the Oregon border. Internal investigations, auditing, grants management, budgeting, and inventory. After that, I was successful, promoted to captain, went to Gilroy, had a wonderful time down there, and had about 54 employees that I supervised in Gilroy. Again, I retired and moved up to where I just came back home. My family and I have lived in Weaverville for 20 years. My kids, we have two daughters. They were raised there, graduated high school, went on to UC Davis. The other one went to San Diego State. Graduated, they moved back to Weaverville. They're both employed there. They live there, and they're going to be staying there, so are we. So appreciate your consideration. Thank you very much for being here tonight.
My name is Mark Potts. I'm a deputy sheriff in the Tunica County Sheriff's Office. I've been there about 20 years now after retiring from my 23-year military career. I'm not going to go into a lengthy review of my past history and my experience. I'm going to save it up. I want to go forward here and talk about what we're going to do for the sheriff's department and the people of Trinity County. So I'm going to keep my introduction short.
I think I know most of you here.
background, I'm born and raised in Trinity County. Family's been here for ages. I work at the sawmills and logging, grocery stores. When they kind of all dried up, I put myself through the academy. And worked at the sheriff's office approximately 21 years ago. Started out on patrol. Had extensive training over the last 21 years. It's been quite exciting for the last 21 years investigating about everything there is to investigate. And you know, I'm kind of like Mark. I know you guys got a lot of questions, and so I just don't want to get into a lot of that. I think a lot of this will be brought up through your questions. So I think we got to just get to the questions and concerns that you people have for us.
Okay, so this one, first of all my questions are all candidates. So, in the spirit of moving things along, we'll time these answers a little so we don't get too drawn out.
What's that?
It's on the question. What do you identify as the biggest issue or problem in the department right now? And what is your plan to fix that? Ron, why don't you go first with that?
All right. Y'all want me to stand up or?
Yes, please. Okay. Thank you.
Oh, I don't know. There's a few issues. I don't know if we have a huge issue, but you know, I think the most nagging one at this point in time is the morale in our department is really low, and and a lot of that comes from the top and works its way down, and so by being a good leader and working with your guys, you can establish a good working relationship with them to build morale. And that is my plan, is to be a working sheriff and be part of what the guys are doing. And so with that, that builds morale, and that helps because if you don't have morale and the guys are just sitting around, you know, being complacent, we're not getting anything done. So we got to have a good leader to build that morale, to get the guys motivated to go out and take care of the communities and be part of the communities. And I see that as the biggest issue within the department. We have other issues, but I think morale is a huge issue. If you don't have the guys on board, then you're not going to get a lot accomplished. So I think having a good leader, working with the guys, and being part of what they're doing, is that's going to build their morale, and that's what's going to get everybody motivated to go out and take care of the things in the communities that we need to do.
From my perspective, I believe the biggest problem within the department right now is manpower. Without the appropriate manpower with which to provide the services, and it leaves us really hurting and wanting. And doing this job on a daily basis, I see it and feel it. We get a lot of responses from the community that the sheriff's office sucks, the sheriff's office not doing that, they're not doing this. And what a lot of people don't understand is we're severely understaffed and undermanned. horrible. Most of the crooks know when we go home at night, and wow, most of the burglaries occur in like 4 o'clock in the morning when nobody's on. That's a huge problem. And it's actually beyond the sheriff to remedy that problem. It's gonna take the community and the government to provide the sheriff the funding to appropriately staff the sheriff's office so they can provide the services to you folks that you deserve. I can't tell you how many times I'm out and cannot give someone the appropriate time they need dealing with their particular case at a certain time. Because I've got to run and put a fire out over here, got a fire over there, got a fire over here, got a fire over there. And the people don't get the appropriate, you're all taxpayers, and you deserve good service from your sheriff's office. And unfortunately, we do demand our authority, just not able to do that. So, and as far as how you're gonna fix that, like I say, I've been in the department for nearly 20 years now, and I went through several administrations and a whole bunch of elections, and every election they say, I'm gonna give you more deputies, I'm gonna give you more resident deputies, I'm gonna get this grant, get that grant, I'm gonna go beg with my little sign and say, I'm a better beggar than you are. That's not gonna fix it. And the best fix that I have come up with, when you have limited resources with which to provide you with services, I'm drawing from the civilian community who can be the eyes and ears of the people. I'm developing a rather robust posse with which to supplement the woefully inadequate manpower of the Sheriff's Department. It's not going to cost us anything. And a really good idea, I think, is an idea that actually I think I came up with before State of Jefferson. Somehow there's plenty of money to field CHP officers. They just hired 3 more. When I started 20 years ago, there was only a handful of them guys. And there were more deputies. Now, the CHP guys outnumber us by 3-1. And those guys are making bank. If I haven't crunched the numbers, but I suspect conservatively if we get away with the Trinity River CHP division and gave that funding to the sheriff, he could conservatively fund positions for 40 deputies. I just wonder if anybody would be willing to press that. I would be. There's a funding source, wouldn't cost us a thing. Get rid of that agency, take that funds, put it over to the sheriff, he's got money for conservatively, like I say, 40 new deputies. It's an idea. Aside from that, utilizing our civilian counterparts more closely than you ever had in my career.
Thank you.
Well, you know, both of these gentlemen here have touched on some key issues. Morale is somewhat of an issue within the department right now, and it stems from lack of personnel. Tired of being called up on their days off to come in and work at all. It's definitely an issue. I tend to go with the fact that I think there is money available. And my experience in the grant community, as well as with the federal government, and looking at alternate funding sources is the key to establishing greater patrol deputies, including resident deputies, which is on my list, number one, to get more resident deputies out there. Part of this also has to do with building stronger ties with our governmental agencies locally. Working with the Board of Supervisors, bringing them plans, and showing them how much money is needed, and then also coming out to the community and saying, folks, if you want to have a deputy here, we need the money, and you as citizens need to pressure your Board of Supervisors to put that additional funding out there. 24-hour coverage is a goal, and you know, I was here when I had 10 officers for the CHP, and there were about 20 deputies working the road, and they were helping us out all the time. It was great. But when you talk about getting rid of an agency, you don't realize it's not just patrol that at the logging trucks that are on our roads day in and day out, making sure that the loads are safe, making sure that the brakes are safe, things like that, and it's public safety. I have plans also to expand the auxiliary, the sheriff's auxiliary, and get them additional equipment. They're a nonprofit organization, and I have experience in working out in the field with resources that contribute and donate to nonprofits to help protect the public. So those are some of the things that I'll be doing.
Since we're sponsored by the Real Estate Association, this is where my questions go towards that area, so bear with me. Do you foresee any kind of code enforcement on things like property trash and encroachments from other people? You know, there's dead cars that are left on other people's yards, there's trash that's piled up in rental units or vacant units and it's leaking over onto other people's properties. I mean, do you foresee any kind of enforcement in that? Mr. Potts?
Absolutely, yes. If you infringe on the property rights of another, you need to know that.
Absolutely. I'm a big Fourth Amendment property rights guy. I believe in you should be able to have your property and be private in your property, but up until the point which you transgress against another person's right to his private property. If your activities on your property are leaching over onto someone else's property, you have just committed an act of aggression against a person, the property is owned, and that should be held down. So, the answer.
Should be able to know that when they call in with a complaint about a neighbor, a complaint about an abandoned vehicle, that something is done about it. So yes, I agree that things need to be done about that, and I believe that enforcement should be taking place. We have an abatement program within the county, that deals with abandoned vehicles on county roads. Unfortunately, they're not fully funded, and they end up running out of money about 3 months into the year. So I would be working with General Services to obtain additional funding for that particular program. Property rights are extremely important. Again, I just echo what Mark said. It's something that if you have an eyesore next door to you and that trash is flowing onto your property, or they have some type of barrels or something and they're leaking something that's unknown onto your property, you should be calling the Sheriff's Department. And then from there, we'll decide whether it's environmental health that needs to take care of it, or abatement, or something like that. But that's it.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Well, that's pretty much what I do every day. I'm currently working in code enforcement, so I handle all these types of calls. Trash, cars, pretty much anything out there that's causing a neighbor to have an issue. I get these calls daily, and we just recently took on another code enforcement officer to help out with these situations, and they are talking about hiring a third code enforcement officer, and as time goes on, I think they want a total of four code enforcement officers to deal with code enforcement issues within our county. Marijuana issues, trash issues, whatever it may be. We are dealing with them the best we can. We're short-staffed, I mean, but we're gaining ground. I mean, we are getting more officers to help in these situations.
This is another one sort of on the same lines, but it deals with people. You know, our homeless population is getting larger and larger by the day, it seems like, in this county. And if you just want to pop open a Facebook, you see in there every day that somebody is being robbed or somebody found somebody sleeping on their porch or something like that. And in my business, we see many homes lose incredible value because squatters show up and they completely trash the place with honey pots left laying around, and they bring trash with them, terrible conditions, and they're bringing all the properties down in those neighborhoods. So, you know, not to mention the related crimes, breaking and entry and trespassing and theft and all of that kind of stuff. So, what is the plan to help out with this issue? And I think we're starting with you this time.
Well, you got like 18 things there.
it's all one question.
It's all one question. It revolves. It's what I'm gathering from your question. It's revolving around the homeless population.
Yes, more homeless is probably unfair. Let's call it squatters for now.
Okay. Well, squatters, especially in the real estate world, squatters, I mean, that is a form of trespass. There are trespass laws in California. The section actually deals with over 30 different violations or types of trespass that you can have, anywhere from an infraction to a misdemeanor up to a felony. Most of the infractions deal with somebody just walks across your property, and you have to have a sign up that says no trespassing. That's what the code says. First time it happens, I get a ticket. Second time it happens, I get another ticket. It happens again, now they can be arrested on a misdemeanor. A lot of these people that are homeless, many of them, it's not their fault. They're victim of circumstance. Just like anyone in this room, at a moment's notice, we could find ourselves homeless. What do? We try and provide as many services as we can in the county for these people. My plan is to get additional training specifically for the road patrol deputies so that when they come in contact with these people, they can relate better with them, understand where they're coming from, and be able to give them access to needed resources, such as behavioral health, maybe HRN, local churches that can provide a room for a night, a meal, to get them out of a situation where they feel like they have to go to an abandoned house and sit there and squat in it. And when we're talking about squatters, it's really incumbent upon all of us in this room to keep an eye on each other's property. And if you know that you have a neighbor that's not there or a property that's vacant, say something about it when you see people on it. The squatter laws in California are pretty much geared towards the person that's not supposed to be there. And there's different things that can be done. I mean, if a person comes onto an abandoned property and they stay there, say they get the electricity put in their name, or they go down and they pay the property tax on this place, in 5 years, they can own it. That's the law. So to clean up some of these things, just in trash alone, my wife and I have been involved in Trek for Trash down here, up in Weaverville, the Weaverville Support Service, where we've been cleaning up creeks and helping people get out of the creeks and get into special service programs. We're also supporting a couple of private entities up there. One of them is the Hope House, where they're trying to get together this place where the homeless people can go and at least get some training or get them off the street. The problem with a lot of these governmental programs, though, is people have to be willing to give up their substance abuse issues, and they have to be willing to get help for behavioral health issues. In Weaverville, they just opened up a new place. It's called Cedar House. I think it's Cedar House. It's a temporary facility for people who are early released from prison under AB 109, and they have been identified as having some substance abuse issues or behavioral health issues. They can go there and get help. And I think that's what it's about. We need to find more ways of helping the people that are in this situation rather than incarcerating them. So that's my plan, is to continue working with the things I am to get additional funding and training for the deputies to help those people.
Well, I think Tim covered a lot of ground there. So.
It was a big question.
So, yeah, other than that, we do have some laws that we can, you know, either write citations for these people that are trespassing. We can arrest them if we believe that they're going to continue to be a trespass issue, then we can arrest them on that. It's just, we're working on a plan on my side because a lot of people come into our county and they get stuck here and they have no way to leave. So we're working on a plan where we can get vouchers. So if these people want to go to Reading or want to go to Humboldt and they just got stuck here, we want to be able to have a voucher plan set up for these people so we can get them back to Reading or Humboldt or wherever they want to be. Because a lot of times they come in, their car breaks down, or they have no means to get out of town. So we're working on this voucher program where we can help these folks get back to where they need to be. Other than that, I think Tim did a pretty good job covering the rest of the areas on that.
So clarification, are we talking about squatters or are we talking about homeless people?
We're talking about the people that break into these empty houses. It seems like I'm working with the property right now. They haven't been on the property in 3 months and somebody moved into their home and created a honey oil lab right there in their home and then dumped all their trash over the side. Right. So if I'm specifically talking about the squatter types that think they have a right just because the home is empty to go in and completely devalue. They're even moving into people's sheds on their property.
I don't think the majority of them think they have a right to. They just do it out of desperation.
Okay.
I deal with them on a daily basis. So. And to think you can arrest some of these people, what even listen here, you're not going to because the jail is over max. We're only allowed by state law to have 53 people in there. Right now we got 63. On a regular basis, we're in the 60s. They're dumping people out of the jail with felonies. So to think you're going to arrest somebody for trespassing and put them in our jail, ain't going to happen. That's just the reality. We end up playing a game of whack-a-mole. I mean, it's the sheriff's responsibility to protect the property rights of the people. So these homeless people, we have a lot of them. And I don't know about the voucher program. Most of these guys don't want to go. If they want to go, I've actually provided the funds to get on the bus to take the bus myself. But that's rare instance. Most of them are here. Got to be somewhere, and I got beat about the head and shoulders when I wrote an article in the paper about the guy throwing an idea about the campground, primitive campground, to move these people into, which it's existing, but it costs anything. It's not the creme de la creme, but it's got facilities, it's got fire pits, you might have fires, they've got bathrooms so they're not urinating, defecating in the woods and the creeks. You can put a trash pickup out there. We know where they're at. We play this game of whack-a-mole. We run them off over here. They show up over here. We go whack-a-mole over there. They show up over here. What people don't understand is they have to be somewhere. And they can't be on private property. That, again, that's the very purpose for the existence of the government, is to protect the right property rights. So, with all these people having to be somewhere, the obvious answer is somewhere on public land, unless somebody can come up with some funding or something to create some housing. And that's above and beyond the capacity of the sheriff. The sheriff can play a part in that, but to think that the sheriff is going to do that is unrealistic.
Okay, thank you, gentlemen, very much. That is the last of my questions, so we can move it on to the audience. Lee, your hand was the first to go up. Why don't you go ahead and ask your question?
So, Jeff, this question is primarily for Mark and Ron. I think that the credentials, the experience, and the ability, I mean, the training and experience that people bring to the job is important, and I think it's important that we hear that. We heard Tim's, so I would like to hear from Ron and Mark about what building blocks they've got that are in place when they are seated as sheriff that they don't have to learn before they can do their job.
Yeah. Well, like I said before, I've been working for the sheriff's office for 21 years. And being a sheriff is, you know, this is a small community that we have, and being a sheriff is more than being just an administrator. A sheriff in our communities is, you know, being part of the communities. And some of my training, you know, I've been to supervisory management schools. I was a field training officer for 14 years in the sheriff's office. I've been a leader to our deputies in the sheriff's office. The sheriff's office in itself is a team, and it's not run by one person, it's run by multiple people. We have an undersheriff, we have a sheriff, and we have a business manager. And it takes all of us to run the sheriff's office. It's just not one person. The gentleman, Mr. Josh Ford, he's going to be my undersheriff. He's got a dual bachelor's degree. He's got a master's degree in business administration. He's going to be a huge asset to the sheriff's office to help with those administration issues. We got a business manager, been there for 10 years. She is extremely busy. We have 14 grants that she's managing to help out with what we need at the sheriff's office. I don't know much what else to say. I mean, I've been there for 21 years. I know how the sheriff's office should run. I sit in with the sheriff, I sit in with the business manager, and I sit in with the undersheriff, find out what they're doing, what I need to do as a sheriff in our department. I don't have a lot of management experience other than my guys. Supervisor in code enforcement, but other than that, you know, that's about it. I've just got 21 years practical experience. I'm well trained in a lot of different areas, and my biggest goal is to, you know, with all this training and experience, is I'm going to be there to protect the people in our county and make our neighborhoods and communities safe. That's my biggest thing, is the communities, the county. I want to take care of all of you people. I mean, that's, to me, that is the biggest thing, is you people are going to elect me to be your sheriff. So I want to do what you guys would have me do. I mean, to take care of you guys. I want to hear what you people have to say, and I want to act on that to make it a safer place for all of us. I'm not living in this county. I was born and raised here, and I just want to, I'm 100% vested in the sheriff's office in this county, so that's kind of where I'm at.
Ron, the best experience is the 20 years in the department doing it, seeing it on a daily basis, going through many administrations, seeing the good things, the bad things, the wrong things, the right things. However, beyond that, prior to my beginning my career in law enforcement, I had a career of 23 years in the military, in which I led 39-man Marine rifle platoons in combat operations, and subsequently served with the United States Army Special Forces, where I led, trained, and in combat operations, 1,000-man battalion. So I think I can handle the job of handling 10 or 15 deputy sheriffs.
Can I get a chance just to say a couple things up there? No question was asked of you, sir. That's right, you did say no. Public safety and the fact that we do have an overcrowded jail, and therefore a major percentage of the arrestees are cited out and put right back out into the public. That's no fault of anybody's except the financial issue, but we don't have enough beds in the jail. Standing that, because of the people being put right back out on the site, they have no financial or any other obligation to appear in court. Therefore, our failures to appear in court have gone up enormously. Consequently, every time they fail to appear, there's a benchmark issue for them. What would be your position as the sheriff to create a somewhat of a team that would be serving warrants to get these people under the standing that it were an infraction or a misdemeanor or a felony, that they have to go back to court and have this case adjudicated? Because right now there is nothing going on at all as far as arresting on warrants that are out there. The warrant number, we can't even find out how many there are, because those numbers will not be given to us by the administration currently. What would be your position? How would you advocate this to the state for public safety to arrest these people that are out there on warrants, just living their normal life, and no recriminations for not going back to court?
Well, I'm not currently working patrol. I'm working in code enforcement right now, but I know that we get a warrant list on a regular basis. They update our warrant list, and I know the guys are diligent about going out there and picking up these people that have warrants. They stay in the jail or not. A lot of times we'll arrest them. We'll go out there and arrest this person because he's got a warrant. We take him over, they cite him out of the jail. I mean, that's just the way it is. I mean, the deputies, Mark will agree with me, we arrest these people, and sometimes they may even get a call. Madman said, do not bring this person into jail. Cite him in the field. So, but the deputies, will go out and arrest everybody that's got warrants. I mean, that's not an issue. We do it, that's what we do, and that's really not an issue. Am I?
Warrant numbers are enormous, and they're going up on a weekly basis. You say you get a list, don't you see that in your list?
Yes.
Yeah, the list is growing longer and longer.
No, no. When that warrant list comes out, there's usually only two or three people on it, on a new warrant list.
Okay.
I mean, maybe I'm misunderstanding what you're asking, but we get, I guess.
He's at a disadvantage. He's not working patrol division, so he's not part of that. He's working code enforcement, so he didn't see all of that.
I haven't worked in patrol in 5 years. So, but I guess maybe we do have a warrant store, and I know
we got
thousands.
You can
imagine. Is that what
you can't imagine?
We do, but you know, a lot of those people don't even live in our county. We've had thousands and thousands of people that have warrants, but they're not. A lot of those people aren't in our county.
Traffic ticket from 10 years ago.
I'm just trying to refer strictly to Trinity County residents.
Trinity County residents. When there's a fresh warrant list comes out, I know the guys are out there constantly looking for these people and arresting them and taking them to jail, or they're being told to cite them in the field.
You got no bed for
them. No. It's not just our county, it's all the counties. We arrest 10 people. They're, you know, we got to figure out who gets let loose. You know, we arrest 10 people, if they're all felonies, now we got to look at the jail and say, okay, which 10 are we going to let out of jail? Somebody's got to make that decision. Who gets to get let go on a citation? And I talked to the sheriff in Shasta County. They typically arrest 20 people a day. Now they got to figure out which 20 are going to get turned loose for the day. It is not just here, it is everywhere. I mean, there's just not enough beds. Yeah, maybe in the future we're going to get this new jail. That's another 20, approximately another 20 beds. That'll fill up almost instantly, and we're going to have the same problem. That's just the way it is. Misdemeanor warrants, they get, if you have a felony warrant, yeah, you might get held to go to court, and then you get released from the courts. It's a problem. But
I guess to clarify my question, do you have any thoughts on how you would change that scenario as sheriff to make the public safer, because the people that are not being held accountable that have committed a crime?
We cannot hold them accountable. I mean, if it's a misdemeanor crime, and if we're full, we're full. I mean, we can't just keep stacking them into jail. Like Mark says, we're already 10 over what we're allowed to have in there right now.
We're supposed to be enforcing law, we're outside the law ourselves.
Yes. We're way out of compliance. And so is every other jail.
So in essence, you're saying there's nothing we can do about the situation?
I can't. I mean, for me right now, here and now, once I get in there, yeah, maybe there's something we can look at, but right now I can't answer that and say, yeah, there's a good answer for that, because I don't see one, because somebody has got to get turned loose. We cannot hold those people in jail. I mean, that's just the reality.
Problem bigger than the sheriff, to be quite honest with you. The sheriff can't fix that. What's the sheriff? Given the constraints we have and the numbers as they are, we have to, I think what Ron was trying to get to is we've got to prioritize. So we, with the capacity we have, I think we're a little slow on the uptake. We're finally coming to the conclusion that when you criminalize almost every human behavior, all of a sudden everybody's a criminal.
Yes.
And that's now coming to fruition, and we're slow on the uptake, and
put that back a little bit.
But to get directly to your point, yeah. Guys scoop up guys on warrants all the time. But, and here's something else. First thing I do when I go on shift is go by the jail and check what the population is. Because that's going to affect how I perform my duties that day.
Sure.
If we got 63 people in there and state law says we can only have 53, unless somebody committed a heinous act, murder, rape, robbery, some real serious felony, I'm not bringing them. You can't. And as far as, even if we had 5 people in our jail, most of these misdemeanors, unless they meet the criteria of 3.6 PC, you're required by law to cite them. That's a state statute. That's beyond the sheriff. He has to follow the state. They're required to cite them. And if that's the requirement, I don't even, he's talking about arrest, citing them in the field.
Yeah.
Why would I arrest somebody, taking my jail to an overpopulated, understaffed jail staff, and make them do a bunch of work by booking this guy when the end result is just write him a citation and cut him loose? When I could have done that in the field and save them guys all that work, because they got 100,000 other things they need to be doing. And that's another thing we're out of compliance with. While I'm talking about being out of compliance at the jail, we've only got 2 people working the jail floor quite often. They're required by state law to have 3. They count our dispatcher, who cannot leave the dispatch console, as the 3rd person on our jail floor, which is really fraud. So it's a tough place to be. And like you said, we pick up warrants. Yeah. But if there are little warrants that's going to be a site, you got to prioritize. The bad is for the bad. Get the bad. Everybody else. That's not a good place, not where you want to be, but that's the reality.
That's right. Okay. Well, Tom knows my position on it, but the rest of you don't, so is it okay? Can I have an opportunity to just talk a little bit? The jail is in a terrible state. Absolutely. It is overcrowded. We're at the max. We need a new jail, which will be filled up as soon as it opens up. I believe we're looking for alternate ways of holding people accountable. You can't do a crime and have no consequence for it, because that just builds upon. People then just don't care. We're raising a new generation of young people who, they'll get a ticket, what's the big deal? Because of changes in the laws, they can take marijuana onto a campus, and if they get caught, it's a ticket. I mean, we have a wonderful juvenile hall up there, but their hands are tied about what they can do with juvenile incarceration right now. Now, with regard to the warrants, a person comes in, he or she gets arrested, they're cited out. That list that comes out on the warrants, I will be working with the probation department to put together teams that can go out, find the people, cite them again, but here's the thing. Get them into court at some point in time, or at least another method of incarceration could be explored, such as electronic monitoring, house arrest, things of that nature, because people cannot continue to just thumb their nose at the law and go, yeah, I've been arrested, so what? There has to be consequence for their actions.
And Ben, what are your plans for dealing with non-compliant marijuana growers?
Well, that's my primary job. The rules have changed a little bit since Prop 64. California says everybody can grow 6 marijuana plants. And the only other way you can grow marijuana is if you get a commercial permit from the state and the county. So everybody that is growing more than 6 and don't have a commercial license, then they are subject to the county codes, which I enforce. So anybody that's non-compliant will formally see me at some point.
What do you do?
What do I do?
What do you do with them once you figure them out?
Okay, so what I do, if I get a complaint or if I see something that's out of compliance, I will go and write a civil citation. We have several ways to do it. What I do is a civil side. What Sergeant Trujillo does is typically on the criminal side. All my citations are civil. I will write them a citation. They have 7 days to come into compliance. If they do not come into compliance, I'll do a follow-up visit, report back to county council, and these people aren't in compliance, and at that point, the fines will start retroactive back to the day that I cited that person, and they'll carry out for 90 days. It can be several.
What does that mean?
What does what mean?
If they're out of compliance and you citate them, what happens then after them? They're just going to look at you and go.
Yes.
So what do you do when they go?
So they have fines, but we can get, the county can issue us an abatement order at some point once all the legal process is over with. But that hasn't been happening much. They haven't issued me an abatement order for a couple of years.
Hasn't issued an abatement?
County council.
They're supervisors?
No.
Yeah.
County council are our attorneys. I write the tickets. County attorneys do all the legal paperwork in the process. I don't particularly care for the ordinance we have now. I would like them to change it, but I'm not getting anywhere. The ordinance we have now deals with, we go into court and attorneys get involved, defense attorneys, our attorneys. It's a long drawn out process. The ordinance I'd like to see our county get is, it's all heard by a hearings officer, and that can happen in a short period of time, and that hearings officer can give me an abatement order that day of the hearing, which allows me to go out and abate the nuisance right then and there. And I'm not getting those abatement orders last year or so. They're not issuing those.
So basically, nothing has happened, and all this money is spent to get to a point where nothing happens, which is not the sheriff.
No, I'm doing all I can. So basically what it boils down to is I'm going out, I'm citing somebody, and all these fines add up. These people pay their fines, and the person that got cited will make an agreement with the county, whatever it may be. There's several different options. And so the person, if somebody's growing next door to you, and you don't like the smell, I go over there and I cite them, and this gets drawn out in court for 3 months. County's getting money, but it didn't solve your issue because there's somebody growing next door to you, and then you have to smell that.
Regulations that, and I tell you, I've been going to the
Board of Supervisors meetings and the Planning Commission meetings for quite some time now. It's amazing, the board is trying to come up with ordinances that comply with the state regulations, and the state regulations keep changing. They'll come down one week and they say one thing, they come up with an ordinance, it goes to planning, planning passes it, but then, oops, wait a minute, the state just changed the regulations again. So you have a system where we have commercial cultivation, we have commercial manufacturing, we have commercial distribution, we're going to have transportation going on. That's all going to be legal if you have your license. Now, to deal with the people who don't have license, actually, as your sheriff, this makes it a lot easier. You either have the right licenses to do it legally, or you don't. And if you don't, then we're going to have our code enforcement people going out there, we're going to be taking action. There is a lot of truth what Ron says. We have to shorten the process through county council to make sure that we can go in. When you get your judgment, they come down. You don't have to wait and wait and wait for something to be done. I plan on working closely with county council, with the CAO, and with the Board of Supervisors to ensure that that gets taken care of.
Training to your employees that need it, and how are you going to fund it?
I guess I'll take it first. Be quite honest with you, they don't do it now. I haven't been to training for a long time.
Yeah, but you're going to be sheriff. Let's say you're sheriff right now.
I don't have a crystal, a magic crystal where I can just make money appear. It has to come from the county. The county funds the sheriff. The sheriff doesn't fund himself. So. I don't know what else you want beyond that.
Okay, so no training when you're a sheriff.
We're not getting training now.
Okay, so there won't be any training when you become sheriff either.
Unless you can pick money off a tree, or you can talk to the people that provide you the funding to do so.
Okay.
Again, reality. It's just reality check. It sucks, but that's the way it is. We're in without in law.
It's not returned. It's okay if I go next. Money is tight. And I know also that required training, is not being conducted like it's supposed to be done. And it's tough when you have a training budget of, I believe the last time it was $10,000 for training. That's two or three classes for technical people like in the narcotics field. Now, the narcotics detectives do have an opportunity to get some grant-funded training. It's very good training, and that's through the federal government, through the state government. But there's a lot of things that need to be done locally. What I plan on doing is, I'm retired from the Highway Patrol, so I have my pensions already done. As your next sheriff, I will be opting out of PERS. So the county will not be paying their portion that would go in to pay for my retirement. So I plan on negotiating with the county to take that money that's already budgeted and put it specifically into a training fund just for the sheriff's department.
It would be real nice if the sheriff's office got paid the way the CHP does so they can do that.
But it has nothing to do with the CHP. It has to do with being retired and then opting out of position with sheriff so that the county doesn't have to pay that much money into
PERS. Right. Right. Yeah. Right. Like, most of the retired CHP officers around here are drawing more sitting at home than most of the deputy sheriffs working
in
the
right now.
Amen.
That's right.
That's right.
I got a question.
Well,
Ron
has an answer.
Yeah. I don't have a good answer for you guys. So.
Thank you.
Let's go to the next one.
I have a question. I want to know how you're going to keep our kids safe. Mark and I have a son. How are you going to keep the school safe? How are you going to protect our Second Amendment rights? That's what I want to know today.
Well, let's be honest, Second Amendment rights. We need to allow our schools to protect themselves. We have to harden those targets. The illegal Gun-Free Zone Act of 1990 that the federal government imposed. imposed upon us is insane. That's why all these mass shootings are happening. You wonder why they happen in a gun-free zone, the most dangerous place on the face of the planet to be. 98% of the gun, all of the mass shootings since 1950 have occurred in these gun-free zones. It'd be nice to, everybody's talking about hiring cops and deputies. We don't have cops and deputies to fund the sheriff's department, for Christ's sake. And we quite often get referred to as first responders. We're not first responders. We show up and clean up the mess. The first responders are the folks that are on site at the time of the shooting. If your staff willingly, teachers, janitors, guidance counselors, are armed, they can put an end to the situation immediately. And that's the best you can do in under ugly, dire circumstances. And to not give those people the right to defend themselves and our children makes me mad.
Was that
for? Yeah, for all of you.
Yeah. I agree with Mark on some of that stuff, and but you know, I think it's really important as a sheriff's office to stay connected with and be part of what the schools are doing and set up plans so we, you know, kind of on the same page. You know, go down, find out what the layouts of the schools are, and you know, have a good working relationship with the schools. And pass on information that would be helpful to school security and give them some ideas of what they could do to stay safer. You know, other than that, you know, like Mark said, you know, we're going to get the call, we're going to get there, there's going to be already something going on, but if we can make a plan to make the school safer and have a plan, so you know, to kind of prevent what you know may happen. Hopefully, it never happens in our county, but you know, it's,
that's what everybody says.
Yeah,
it'll never happen here, but it happens.
Well,
everywhere.
You know what? It could happen.
And my
just like school. Anywhere.
I walked the campus the other day and wasn't even stopped.
Yeah,
so,
it's
you know, it's real sad. It can happen anywhere.
And I've contacted a couple school officials and. Regarding these issues, and we've talked about, because I went to there to the school just specifically see what would happen. It was a one little private school here in Hayfork, and I knocked on the door, and just to see, and they opened the door. And I go, did you check before you opened the door? And they said, yes. We looked out. We saw the police car. So we then opened it up and let you in. I said, I was wondering, and just, because that's really important. You need to know who is there before you open up that door, because you never know when this is gonna happen or where it's gonna happen. So we gotta be prepared and take steps like that to protect our kids in the schools.
Thank you.
You know, a few years ago, there was a bill passed that allowed school superintendents to individually, in their districts, let people with CCWs, let teachers with CCWs, carry them on campus. And unfortunately, for whatever reason, we have a governor that signed a bill this year saying that no, it's out of the hands of school superintendents. There will be no weapons on school grounds, period. You know, I'm of the opinion that we need to get back to the situation. Every district in this state is different. Every county in this state is different. Because of our limited resources and extended response times, like Mark said, we're supposed to be first responders, and yeah, we're going to be the second and third person there. We do need to have trained individuals that are willing to carry a weapon in our schools, but they need to go through training that's through the Sheriff's Department so that they understand the dangers involved in carrying, because you see somebody with a gun, you're gonna go and take them out. What if you miss? You need to be trained what's behind that person. Are there kids running away that you might possibly hit? These are important things, that they're a training issue. One of the things I want to do is reinstitute the school resource officer that we used to have here, that partnered up with the juvenile counselor, and they went to the schools as a team to look at school issues, to address drug issues, to address truancy issues, which, I mean, that's a big, huge thing right now because truancy is on the rise. I've talked to three principals, and the numbers of kids not going to school is going up. Trinity County gets about a little over $7,000 average daily attendance per student per year. So every day that student is not in school, that's money being lost in our educational system to pay our educators, to pay for upgrades to the schools and things of that nature. But absent that, it's a team that can go into the schools and on a regular basis spot things that are security issues, can look at things, and can provide additional training. Sheriff's Department has got a great active shooter program, and they're putting it on, and we just, I want to expand that to the educators in our schools, and I've talked with some substitute teachers. They don't get the training, just the regular teachers, but at any point in time, you're going to have 20% of your school that's got substitute teachers. What if something happens? They're not trained in what to do in that particular school. So training is extremely important from that standpoint. Anyway, that's my point. That's what I want to do and help our schools thank become safer.
Thank you.
Okay, well, first of all, thank you guys. You guys are really on the spot right here. So this is a major election. You guys are gonna be the top brass, so I appreciate you coming out here and explaining your guys' position to all of us. This is a big concern, and I'm just jumping in here real quick just to go right off of that last point. We've talked a lot about the limited resources. We've talked about we haven't talked quite yet about response times throughout the county if somebody's in Northern Trinity, if there's an issue going on in Southern Trinity, whatever, it might take you 2 hours to get there.
Six in some
places. Okay, so it could be yeah, crazy. So you could, so you might just bring the coroner and said that would be a very, you know, terrible situation. So this is my question. I have, you guys are here to explain to us what your position is on many things so that we can, you know, calibrate you guys and decide who we want to lead our county. So I would like to know what you guys feel about the Second Amendment in general, just real quickly, whether you support it or whether you don't, whether you think, after a background check that citizens should have a rifle, an AR pistol, it doesn't matter what it is, do you think that we should be able to have own firearms? Secondly, the CCW process, unless it's changed, you take a class, you train on how to handle a firearm, you shoot, you apply to the sheriff's office, and then you have an interview with the sheriff. So these guys right here are gonna decide who is going to carry a concealed weapon, whether it's a teacher, whether it's somebody that works at, you know, a grocery store or whatever. So the first question is, how do you feel about the Second Amendment, whether people should own guns, period? That's just a personal question that I wanna know for each of you. And then also what your position on the CCWs are. If you are in fact against it, what action you're gonna take if you're elected when you, with the people who are currently holding CCWs. So, there.
Absolutely support the Second Amendment. Absolutely support your right to have a CCW, as long as legally everything is right. And I will sit down, I look forward to interviews and talking to everybody and find out, why do you want a CCW? Are you trained, and do you feel comfortable if you had to take a human life? Because that's what a CCW is for. That's why you have a weapon, is to protect yourself, protect your family. So you're gonna have to be willing to do that at some point in time if push comes to shove.
I'm sorry, I have to do question two, part B. As far as the CCW goes, the concealed weapon permit, so you can carry with concealed. The other question I was gonna have that you were just speaking to was if somebody has, you know, the adequate training as the sheriff, what's the adequate training gonna be? Are the classes that are required right now adequate, or are you gonna have something through the sheriff's office additionally from what's right now?
I think that the classroom training that they do right now is very good. I personally would like to see more hands-on firing training at the range to get your CCW. Realizing though, there are a lot of people don't have that opportunity. People down here having to come all the way up to Weaverville to shoot at the range or whatever. And then there's staffing. Who's going to be at the range to qualify you and things like that. It's something that I have been thinking about and I want to consider, but I can't commit to that right now because of staffing levels.
What was the other part of the question?
The other part was, right now, if somebody has a qualified CCW, when you become the sheriff, when they are going to renew and they've passed the requirements at the time with Sheriff Haney, are you going to honor those?
Yes.
Without the additional training, as a renewal?
As a renewal.
Okay.
I will.
All right, thank you.
Personally, I don't like the CCW process, because that all that represents is you have to ask permission to exercise your Second Amendment rights, which was never meant to be. If I'm the sheriff, the Trinity County will become a Second Amendment zone, so to speak. You ever heard of constitutional carry? Many states, there are many states, more of them every year, that's passing legislation referred to as constitutional carry, which is that you don't have to ask the government's permission to carry a weapon pursuant to the Second Amendment, which is already your right. So it's a silly process to have to ask permission to exercise your right. The government has no authority to prohibit that right. However, I would still issue the CCW permits so that you are covered in other jurisdictions. If you leave Trinity County, where somebody's going to require that, then you'll be covered. You'll have your little permission slip, so that you're okay.
Well, I'm with Mark. I don't feel that we need a permit here, but, you know, so along with that, I'm going to continue the process we have, and I'm going to honor the current CCWs. I hear from a lot of people in the communities that they do want more trainings when they go to these classes. They want to be able to shoot more. They want to learn how to handle their firearms more. And sometimes some of these courses don't give them that. So, I think people, they want to get more training, I think they should, because, you know, the better they can handle a firearm, the better they're going to be able to protect themselves with it. Do you have anything, Kenny?
No, they covered it.
Okay. Awesome.
Thank you.
Back in the corner.
Go ahead, ma'am.
What about AR-15s, other sorts of military rifles, and bump stocks? What are your position on those?
Ma'am, an AR-15 is not a military rifle. having spent 23 years in the military, I know what a military weapon is. An AR-15 is not one. However, the Second Amendment is all about military weapons. That's exactly what the Second Amendment was written for, is to protect the people's right to carry military weapons over throw off an oppressive government. And it's exactly that thing that kicked off the revolution, and we're coming up on an anniversary next month, Patriots Day, 19th of next month. The day the first shot was fired at the Lexington Dream, when the British Redcoats were coming to seize guns to the colonials. That's what started the war in the first place. And the very reason the Second Amendment exists is so that we, the people, have the means to throw off oppressive government. That's the very purpose of it.
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
The military weapons that existed at the time the Second Amendment was written are not the military weapons that
you are
have
correct,
today.
Ma'am.
So
also, the government weapons
I'm not
they didn't have tanks and
question.
Missiles.
I'm not done asking my question.
Oh, ma'am,
I'm sorry. So when you say that you personally believe that the Second Amendment gives everyday people the right to have military weapons, where do you draw the line? Are nuclear ground-to-air missiles okay? Are nuclear weapons
okay? Your government has them, yes, ma'am. I can't afford one. Can you?
I'm asking you if you consider that a right of the
absolutely,
everyday
ma'am.
Person to have
that,
nuclear
that's the
weapons.
Very purpose of the Second Amendment, to maintain the armament to throw off an oppressive government.
Nuclear weapons.
Can you afford one, ma'am?
I'm asking you if you think that everybody
absolutely,
should
yes,
be able to have
absolutely. Your weapons. Government has nuclear
okay,
weapons.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted
yes,
an answer. Thank you.
Go ahead. There's been rumors half-cent sales tax to Trinity County's sales tax specifically geared towards law enforcement in Trinity County. Knowing this takes a two-thirds vote in order to pass anything specifically here on any tax, what would be your position if this passes and it is advocated that a citizen group would be over in charge of administering these funds, working with the sheriff, so the sheriff could delineate where this is needed, but only could do so with approval by a citizen group? Would your ego get in the way and you're saying, this is the sheriff's purview, I will not work with a citizen group? I'm looking for a campaign promise from all three of you on your position on that.
Well, yeah, I got most of it, I think. Well, I'm just trying to go over kind of what you said in my head here. Well, you know, first of all, I think I kind of mentioned this earlier. It's the people that are electing me to be the sheriff. So I want to do what the people would have me do. And if that's helping out administering this, well, why not? I'm not opposed to that one bit. And
get direction from the citizens advisory group.
Well, why not? This is a citizen advisory group.
The sheriff would have an ego, they wouldn't let that happen.
Well, I'm not afraid to ask for help at all. I mean, if somebody's got a good idea, it's a good idea. It don't matter where it came from. So that's where I'm at on that.
If we were able to pass a half-cent sales tax and you're specifically for law enforcement, instead of giving the sheriff the full right, 100% of the authority to administer that fund, those funds, and if it had to go through a citizens oversight committee, that would then have to, before the sheriff could spend a dollar of it, had to have approval of this oversight committee on where that money was going to go, would your ego get in the way of not letting you work with us?
Well, you would always work with somebody, but I don't know if that's a good way to fund the sheriff. We kind of have that problem now with the grant process. The sheriff gives grants from people, but that money is directed towards a particular mandate, so the sheriff can't spend that money as he sees fit. That's a problem with the federal funding. You know, it's a misnomer. The sheriff has 10% of his budget is federal funding because it's not really, it's a mischaracterization of the sheriff's budget. It's not his budget at all. He just becomes a conduit for federal money, and what he does is he rents his deputies out to the federal government to perform a federal function, which is not helpful to residents of Trinity County. But I just don't
wait. Make this more simple.
Please.
I'm a simple man. If you had a $50,000 check every month come into the sheriff's department, but you couldn't spend it unless you had this group of citizens oversight committee agreed with where you were going to spend it. In other words, going to go buy all the uniforms that you're bringing for officers, deputies? Going to go buy a fleet of new cars? Or are you going to put more deputies on the street to protect the public? If they told you it had to be deputies, would you work with them to make that happen?
Well, sure. If you
what if you wanted the car?
If you got a funding source, why would you turn away a funding source when we're so strapped for money? Absolutely.
Okay. So you would work with the citizens?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Depends who's on the committee. But generally speaking, my ego would not get in the way. If money's coming in from tax dollars and the people of this county voted for it to go into law enforcement, I absolutely would be in favor of that. I would also want to see it at the table, though, as one of the votes. I would not want strictly a citizens oversight group on that. And it would I would hope to be able to play a role in the types of people that get on that, not make the ultimate decision, but to make sure that there's people that truly care about providing law enforcement services to Trinity County.
Mr. Saxon, I have a question that only one of you needs really to answer.
Why me?
I mean,
why not?
How many sheriff's deputies are there in actuality? Because you say that you can't do 24-hour, because it's, I would assume because of scheduling for a small amount of deputies. So how many do we actually have?
When you talk field deputies, road patrol deputies right now, it, correct me if I'm wrong, because the last number I heard was 9.
9?
That's probably how I...
8. And what's 8?
We just lost another one to code enforcement. So there's every time they need a code enforcement, this or that, they draw from patrol and it leaves us with...
So
there's 8 deputies, 7 days a week for 20 hours a day.
But then how many code do you have, I assume?
Right now there's 2.
2 codes, so
there's
that's
funding
10.
For one more, and
so
then
that's
there's
10 people.
Okay, they're...
But they're segregated into...
When you say deputies, road patrol deputies, are those deputies assigned to road patrol?
Right.
You're talking code enforcement deputies, there's 2 now. In an emergency, that's a valuable resource, because if they're out doing code enforcement duties and an emergency happens, they're sworn deputies, boom, they're there. So that's additional resources, but not on a regular scheduled basis.
Who does the scheduling for the 8 that you do have?
That would be the sergeant in charge of patrol.
And he would be under you? Or the sheriff?
Well, the under sheriff,
new position.
Well,
is
yeah.
There a
there's
why,
a lieutenant also.
Is there a reason why out of 8 people we couldn't schedule them for 24 hour or at least 22 hours?
Well, it has to do with the number of hours they can work in a day.
Well, absolutely,
right.
But can't they, like, they have, what, 7 to 3, 3 to 11, 11 to midnight?
If you have enough people to overlap, absolutely. But with days off, vacations, sick time, things of that nature.
I'm just asking,
yeah,
because I had no idea how many
And that's what I, you know, as a field sergeant down south, I was doing schedules for anywhere from 24 to 35 people. And you have to plug in training days, you plug in sick, you know, all these things that happen.
I've had to do those things myself.
Yeah.
I didn't know how many to begin with that you had to work with.
How many additional officers are there besides the patrol deputies and the code enforcement? How many more do we have?
Gosh, there's 1, 2, 3, 4 sergeants. And I've lost count of number of deputies. I don't know. The corporals. I don't remember how many corporals they have.
Well, I tend to remember by division. You got
this. This is a joint answer because
We've got, and they just reorganized. They've got this super special detectives division now that consolidated the narcotics task force and the detectives division that
major crimes task force.
Okay.
Major crimes task force.
And there's
4
guys in there. And
sergeants.
You got the 2 sergeants, and we got one corporal.
So it sounds like you're working with a total force of 14.
Oh, ma'am, even with 8 people.
I'm just trying to give a total.
I can't tell you how many times I spend a shift covering the entire 3,200 square mile county by myself.
No, that's too many. Mm-hmm.
Scary.
How much service can I really render, you know, with one person? If I'm not, there's quite often times that I'm tied up on sitting down at the hospital with a 5150 or I'm doing the court transports because the jail's short. So I'm standing in the courthouse with court transports. Nobody's out there to answer the calls for service. It's just horrible.
I intended my question for all 3 candidates, please.
I'm sorry, what was your question?
I'll take it. Well,
you
answered it.
Oh,
this was about the AR-15
and bump stocks and
bump
military, all those sorts of things.
As Mark pointed out, the AR-15 is not a military rifle. It's styled after military types of weapons.
And I'm talking about military types.
Yeah, but the AR-15 is not. And you're talking about people owning military weapons? I applaud these 2 individuals for their service to our country. And here we are in the VFW hall, and you know they've done a wonderful time. But I don't think the average citizen needs to have military assault weapons. That's my answer.
I feel about assault rifles is, yeah, they're used and abused just like any other firearm. It don't really matter what it is. If people want to do something bad, they're going to use whatever means they have to carry out that. So my position is I'm going to enforce the laws of the state in our county. And as far as somebody's got a AR-15 and they're legal to carry it, so be it. I'm not going to say I am against them. I'm not going to say that. But you own one, and I know a lot of people that do, and they're legal. If they're doing something illegal with it, then they should answer to that. But I'm definitely not against them.
What are your feelings on, all three of you, what are your feelings on asset forfeiture as far as the officers collecting money from different individuals, pulling them over on a traffic stop, and then patting them down for cash and taking the cash? I mean, thousands of dollars is being brought in. If you look at the newspaper, thousands of dollars.
Millions. Billions at the federal level.
Right.
It's absolutely unconstitutional. It would not occur with me as sheriff. It's basically highway robbery. They're stealing your property from you. And it won't happen with me as sheriff.
I believe in asset forfeiture only if it's done with due process. That's the only time. Not just arbitrarily taking it from the side of the road. That's it.
If these officers are taking money in a legal fashion and acting within the guidelines of the law, then there's not an issue with me.
This is for all of you. Is there any reason why we can't use more of our personnel in the Sheriff's Department to put them as patrol instead of behind a desk? Why is there so many administrative, whether they're sergeant or what have you? Can we get them out in the field? Like, for instance, then we could have more officers, one near each school that's maybe stationed near the school or something of that nature. I think that we should utilize them more in the field, and could that be done?
We're a really small department, and I know our detectives, and I think you're referring to the detectives and the narcotics officers, because they're the ones that are not on patrol. I know what those guys do every day, pretty much, and for the most part, they are buried in paperwork. They don't have time to take a patrol shift on. Yeah, there may be times when they're not, but we just don't have enough bodies to go around and do all the work there is to do in our county. It would be nice to be able to have to utilize those guys, but everybody is maxed out. We do a lot of different functions within the sheriff's office, and you know, I'm just thinking about it. There are times, you know, during the winter months that it's slow, but and they can maybe be out there as a sec to perform some of these issues, but not on a full-time basis. No, that would never happen.
It's unrealistic. Never happened. Those guys are small all the time. One of the two detectives, he spends 80% of his time with dead bodies, doing autopsies and all the follow-up. And, I mean, 80% of this one deputy's job is just dealing with death and all the investigatory process that goes along with that. Those guys are buried, just like we are. And unfortunately, a lot of it generates paperwork. I like to say 5 minutes of work and 5 hours of paperwork. few minutes of work, and now I got to come back and sit down and write a bunch of paperwork. It takes up a lot of our time. And they're actually trying to work on a new system where we can maybe make that more efficient to where we spend less time with paperwork, but it's absolutely unworkable to think that you're going to get guys out of the office to go perform those functions. In emergencies, you got shooting, big, you know, they can break away for a few minutes, but they're just small.
It is a very small department, and everybody has specific duties that they're assigned to do. Some of them are required by the state, some of them are required for reporting purposes. But like was just pointed out, when an emergency comes out, everybody rolls. The sergeants roll, the sheriff rolls, the undersheriff rolls, detectives, everybody goes. And that's what we expect them to do. One thing that I'm thinking about exploring, and I really haven't thought this all the way out, but I would like to see, because every uniformed officer has perishable skills, if they don't perform those duties every so often, you kind of lose your edge. I would like to see some type of a program where once or twice a year, those in administrative patrol or administrative functions go out on patrol for a shift. And it's not, you probably can't do it all the time, but I'd like to explore that at least and talk to them. And once I get elected, I'll be talking to the staff there and see if, what their feelings are on this. But I think it's extremely important that you don't forget where you came from. You came from patrol, or you came from, you know, corrections, whatever. But that's my plan on it.
I have a question for all three of you. Can you tell me how your knowledge would apply to a voucher program with the federal government, the state government, and local county governments, and how you could utilize that to solve all these problems we're addressing?
No, we currently have a voucher program, but it's sponsored by the local churches, and how that works is for transients passing through the area. If you're a local resident, a Trinity County resident, that service is not even available to you. You have to be a transient passing through. You go to a local church and they'll give you a voucher for either gas, food, a hotel room or something, and you come by the sheriff's office and we provide the finish, consummate the things, so to speak. And but like I say, for the locals, all the homeless people, the people that are, that service is not available to them.
As a work voucher.
A work voucher?
Yeah, work voucher.
Elaborate, please.
Work vouchers where the federal government or the local governments have supplied a project to do, and we can put the prisoners to work. And they're funded through that program and transferred back and forth to different facilities.
I don't know how that would work. It would require funding. I mean, like we've already hashed out, we don't have manpower to supervise the inmates in the jail now.
No, you wouldn't.
Let alone get them out and supervise them in a work environment.
You wouldn't supervise them. The voucher program pays for that. But yeah. Okay, I just wanted to know about it.
To be quite honest with you, I have no knowledge on that and how to make that work or how to make that come to fruition.
Got it.
I've not heard of that program, but is it something similar to what CDF does with the CONCAP, where they send the prisoners out, and they fight fires, or they do cleanup and things like that?
Same idea, and they're paid a minimum wage, but for their services.
And this is money that comes in to the county or to the city, to the correctional system.
That's correct.
I'm not familiar with that, but it's a great point, and I will look that up.
Okay.
So. I would be open to that.
Can you go ahead and ask that question again? Because I just
This is a work voucher program that is applied to the being over populated in our prisons and reducing the cost of housing and nutrition for these people, where projects are developed by local governments and we transport our prisoners to the projects and back and forth
and that cost is funded by the project.
So you want them, are you talking about like a work center where they generate money?
They're transferred from the prison to the job site, they work, and then they're brought back.
So I'm not really understanding what I'm sorry.
I just wanted to be new about the program, that's all. The feds have it.
It was kind of, Creature Creek had a work program where they would come in. They'd take the people from jail down to Creature Creek, and they'd work on highway to byway, and they would give them so much money. But they had to work to get their, whatever they want, cigarettes, tobacco, whatever, or, you know, they had to supply it.
Crystal Creek.
And it was a good thing. It was a good place. There was a lot of good kids from here went there, and so they've done some of them real good, and some of them hasn't, you know. But that's where it's people you don't know about. Some of them's gonna be good. Some of them's not gonna be good. Some of them you can work with, and some of you can't. I mean. It's all kind of people, and it takes all kind of people work. And you, the thing is, people need to work together. They need to unite and work together as a unit, some way to protect citizens as well as the criminals. They need to do something, and it's sad. I mean, my heart goes down because I've seen a lot of people hurt because they don't respond to tips.
Well, I just want to, since I'm really, you know, Mark and I were just kind of discussing, you know, we don't know what you're getting at and what the objective is. It just to have a work program for these people to give them the inmates something to do? Is that what you're getting at? Mm-hmm.
Subsidize your cost and provide training, getting them ready to come out into the society. We can do an apprenticeship program, for example, in all trades.
I think they may be confusing it with the Cal Fire con camp.
Right. No, it's not confused. It's the federal program is here.
Yeah, and I don't know if that's, I mean, that's just something we're going to have to look and see if it's doable somewhere down the road. Mm-hmm. But, you know, when I first started working for the sheriff's office, we had the sentenced inmates. We had a work crew. They'd go out and do road projects around the county. I don't remember who monitored those. I don't remember who did it, but anyway, there was a work crew that went out and worked on the highways, picked up trash, and did things like that. But that didn't last long.
You need the project. You're right.
It's just something we could look at. I mean, if it's something that, you know, if it's something that we think is going to be beneficial to the sheriff's office, yeah, maybe we can look at that.
Do you have a follow-up question on that? And Ron was shown, because you've been there a long time, you used to have a trustees program where you would, you know, give agencies, schools, and other agencies trustees. Is that something that could be instituted again? I mean, I think it was a value to the trustees. There was some, you know, training going on, but it did go by the wayside. But I always kind of thought it was because the sheriff's department didn't want to do it anymore.
You know, and I don't know what the reason
is. And is that a personnel issue for you?
You know, and I don't know why it went away. I know they used the trustees for going over, helping out at the animal control.
We did a lot of work.
And Christine would take them out. They'd bring them over here, and they would help with the cleanup with the county buildings. And I don't know why they did away with that. And that's something worth looking at. I mean, why not use the inmates to take care of some of the issues in our county, you know, projects like that, house cleaning or brush removal or whatever it may be. Yeah, we should utilize our inmates for that.
Wouldn't you need a deputy to watch them while they're doing their work stuff?
No.
Which means no.
No.
Go ahead, Mark. The previous program, they were low-level offenders, and then they were that, thereby the terminology trustee, they were trustworthy inmates that had low level, and they had already been sentenced just doing their time, not a threat to society, so workers felt comfortable with taking these guys out doing work, thereby not requiring a deputy.
Then you still need the bureaucracy to follow along paper-wise.
Well, I don't know that there was a lot attached to that. I'm with Ron, I don't know why that went away. They used to use the inmates also for care and maintenance around the outside of our facility, and that went away, and I know why that went away. That went away because we don't have, they need to be supervised, and well, they need to be supervised. Yeah. So.
As he said, they were called trustees because they could be trusted to go out for their time, do their job, and then come back at the end of the day. Again, I don't know what's changed either, other than the fact that perhaps there was some legislation that said you couldn't use inmates to do work anymore unless you paid them. They have an inmate bill of rights. There might be something there, but it would...
Title 15.
Yeah. So, definitely, that's another good idea to explore, but there was probably a reason why it stopped.
I have a question. What do you want to leave behind as a legacy as a sheriff? What are you planning on doing? What type of legacy do you want to leave behind? That's the first question. The second question, are you guys going to be busy in Washington, D.C. getting money in Sacramento? Or are you going to be on the street answering calls, picking up dead bodies, being called in the middle of the night? What is it you plan on doing as sheriff? Are you planning on doing administration? Are you planning on beating the streets? Are you planning on doing all of it? Are you planning on people writing grants for you and you doing the work, doing the work of Mark and Ron? What is it your plans are? So it's kind of a double question. What's your legacy? What's your goal? And what's your plan once you get in there? What do you plan on doing? Because nobody sees Haney. Nobody knows where he's at. So please tell me what you plan on doing.
I'm not worried about legacy. It's not about me. It's about the people. So I don't even consider legacy. That's not a thought that comes to my mind. It's about doing the job effectively. And as far as the sheriff going out and answering calls for service, like I said earlier, I've been at the department almost 20 years now, and I've went through several administrations, and every 4 years I hear all these great campaign promises they're going to do, and that's one of them. They're going to go out and answer calls for service, knowing well that is not going to happen. It can't happen. They've got too many other duties to do to make that happen. So don't worry about my legacy. And
what's your goal?
Most likely will not be answering calls for service because I've tied up with administrative duties and supervisory duties.
What's your biggest goal?
To do the best job I can for the people of Trinity County.
Thank you.
Can you ask me the question again?
What type of legacy or what type of goal are you setting for the department, for your job and your position? Do you want to leave a legacy? Do you have a goal that you want to accomplish while you're in office? It's good to always set goals and achieve them. And then the next one is, what is your plan? If you're in sheriff's office, are you planning on still working for the planning department? Or do you plan on beating the streets, becoming a deputy part of the week and doing admin part of the week? Are you going to hire people to write grants? Are you going to be behind a desk? Are you going to be out there beating the streets? Are you going to be in Oregon? In Nevada, what is your plan?
Well, I'm not going to Oregon. I'm staying around. Take a lot to get rid of me. I want to be a proactive sheriff, and that don't mean handling calls for service. I want to be involved with what my crew is doing. That don't mean I'm going to be out handling calls. I want to be involved with what they're doing. Taking care of the administrative needs of the sheriff's office. And one of my goals as being a sheriff is to, I worked in Hayfork for 15 years on patrol, and I've got a really good relationship with the people here, and I've taken care of the people in our town for years. And as a sheriff, that's what I want to do with the whole county. Get the deputies and the communities together to be able to work together and solve issues that we have in our communities. I mean, that's really all I want to happen as a goal, is to have that good working relationship between the counties and the sheriff's office and fix the problems that we have in our communities.
As I mentioned when I start this, my two kids went away to college and they came back here. That means my wife and I aren't leaving. We're staying here. We're not going to be moving to another state. As far as legacy goes, I agree. It's not about the person that's sitting in the chair that's getting all the paperwork filled on the desk. It's about the men and women that work within the sheriff's department, making them the best I possibly can, getting them the training that they need, providing promotional opportunities, and developing a succession plan so that people know, okay, this person's gone, here's the two most qualified people that have been developed, have gone to training, have gone into management skills, understand what is needed in the communities around our entire county. We're so spread out. I've been to different places and they say, who's the sheriff now? Only because, you know, and for whatever reason. But I'm, throughout my career, I learned how to be engaged in each of the commands I went into. Each of the commands was like the same size as the sheriff's department here, or bigger. And by being engaged, it's just like Ron was saying. You have to sit down and talk to the janitor. You sit down and talk to your communications operator for the shift. What's going on? You have staff meetings. You become engaged in what your people are doing. Another thing I plan on doing also is having at least twice a year in every large community around, including Hayfork, is I want to come out and have community meetings. I want to come out during whatever hours are best for the community and sit down and talk. This is what's going on with the Sheriff's Department. Here's where our budget is right now. Here's how many grants we are. Here's how many people we've been able to add. I'm hoping. You know, which is, it falls right into recruitment retention as well. I have had a lot of experience with recruitment. I plan on going to the various colleges around here at graduation time for post academies and sitting down with these people, telling them what a nice place Trinity County is. Yeah, you're not going to make the money you're going to make in Santa Clara. But here's the thing, look at what we have to offer. Beautiful communities. We have friendly people. We have hiking. We have fishing. We have just about anything you could ever want. People go, well, yeah, but you're just going to train them and then they'll leave. Okay, we get a chance to train them how we want them to police our county. And if they choose to leave, then we'll go down to the college and we'll get another one. That's how I believe in it. When you're talking about being out and about, I plan on going to Sacramento. And if I have to, I will go to Washington to beat on doors to get more money for Trinity County. And maybe not only for law enforcement, maybe for our schools, maybe for whatever it takes. But I'm big on collaborations with other agencies within our county to work together, because you can't do it alone. You have to share the responsibility.
Getting into it, so we're going to ask just a couple of more questions now. Go ahead.
I didn't mean to interrupt. Her question was kind of a great closer question, but so my question is in regard to the Office of Emergency Services. That was switched to now Health and Human Services handles that, you know, as I read in the newspaper. And it was my understanding that there was a lieutenant that was promoted to run that, and that his salary is being paid for out of the sheriff's budget. And since that's now under Health and Human Services, you know, is that true? And do you agree with that? Would you make changes? And I also understand that the Board of Supervisors had opted to not fund that position. So do you think the money could be spent differently? And it's to everybody, the salary.
Yes, they did create a new position, the lieutenant, and it was, he kind of created it himself. Don't ask me how that happens, but, and yes, it is true that the directorship was transferred to Health and Human Services, which is, I don't quite get that. it's up in the air right now. I'm not quite sure if there's talk going on with the DSA and the county of what they're gonna do with that. I'm not really in that loop because I'm not a full paying member of the DSA, so I really don't know where that's going. But they really need to get that directorship back to the sheriff, who has all the equipment and the manpower to go out and do the job. That was a
We're gonna give the gentleman a chance to answer.
She's had her hand up for a long time.
It's okay.
Well, you're not.
She's had her hand up.
The
question was to all three, please.
I'll be fast. Okay, the issue of the lieutenant position within the department, that's something that the current administration needs to deal with. With my administration, I will be going through the budget line by line, looking at each position and whether or not those positions are required or needed within the department. He mentions the DSA. Yes, absolutely. The DSA plays a role in that because you have a position that wasn't originally funded within that budget year and now is being taken out of the current budget with no additional funds coming in. So you have to look at the duty statement for that position and whether or not it's going to be required and then adjust from that point. Whether it means the individual going back to the previous classification he or she was at, or just looking at it from that standpoint.
Yeah, there's a lot going on with that lieutenant position, and I will be evaluating each of the positions in the sheriff's office. I will be having down meetings with all the employees and hearing from them, and I think there's a lot that can be tightened up in the sheriff's office. And but as far as the OES thing, yeah, I think it needs to come back to the sheriff's office because it's part of the sheriff's office and it needs to be there and somebody administering that from our office.
Thank you.
I don't think most people realize how much the Board of Supervisors controls what the sheriff does and can do through the manipulation of their budget. So your very generous offer of putting your money towards an officer instead of PERS probably won't happen. Even though you mean well and it's completely logical, you will be surprised what the Board of Supervisors does that they should talk to the sheriff about. So this is kind of for you guys and the public to know how your hands are tied, and people need to hold their Board of Supervisors, not Supervisor Chadwick as much, accountable for what they do. They're arbitrarily moving people about. So my question for you is, how are you going to deal with the Board of Supervisors who holds the purse strings? And I'll tell you what, I've seen the sheriff's office get money from a grant and see the Board of Supervisors take that same amount. And people don't realize that. When you have that big pie chart that says public protection, and they go, oh, no, it's not. And people don't realize that the sliver that's the sheriff's money. And so people here need to take back their Board of Supervisors office to allow sheriffs to run the sheriff's office the way they need to, and also to allow you guys to get more money. But what I worry about is a lot of times the sheriff ends up bowing to the will of the Board of Supervisors because of that. How would you handle the Board of Supervisors manipulation of your funds, moving someone that inappropriately and as punishment, basically, oh yes, that's what they did. How would you deal with the supervisors as a body to stop that and get control of your sheriff's office budget again?
Okay, well, I wish you all luck with that.
I hope this is the last question of the night. Yeah, this is going to take a long time. My experience throughout my law enforcement careers is I work on building bridges. I work on communicating with people. My hope and my plan is to work closely with the Board of Supervisors to discuss with them what my plans are, why they're important to the people of Trinity County, and that is the Board of Supervisors' primary job is to make the people safe. That's their primary responsibility.
as far as I've heard the stories, I've heard people talking about grants come in and the board supplants the budget. That means taking the money out of the budget because they got grant funding, which is illegal. You can't do it. The only thing to do is you just got to hold their feet to the fire. The people in the county need to hold their supervisors' feet to the fire and say, you know what, you either do it the right way or somebody else will be voted in.
Well, to kind of add to that, would you be willing to enforce code enforcement against the Board of Supervisors?
I would leave that to my code enforcement officer.
There's a politician.
I would support whatever decision he or she makes.
You're absolutely right, and you know, I've seen it happen to more agencies than the sheriff's office, and that is a huge problem. And I'm not going to stand here and give you a plan, because you know that's going to be, you know, once I'm in there as sheriff, then I can start working on that issue. But you know, today I don't have a plan. So, but that's something that's going to come down the road once I'm elected. It's I know it's a huge problem, but and I don't like it. So, but that will come later.
Expose their dastardly deeds to the people, thereby allowing the people to put the pressure on them. And if, absolutely, if they break a law, a code, a statute, then as the chief law enforcement officer of the county, it's my duty to arrest them, yes.
Did you have a question?
Well, yeah, I better watch my mouth. I have some books here. This one here says the Bible writes.
Thanks.
This one here says the Holy Bible.
Amen.
This one, the words of Jesus I love.
Amen.
You guys are talking about budget and money and stuff. I was going to bring up money. I have a check in my pocket for $1 billion. It's all my money. Is it true? Did you see it? No, I didn't. Okay, so right here's a math calculation for $546,723.80. That's for 1 week, starting in September of 1992. That's the number required by law to give to me for every single week from September of 1992 on up to right now when I'm speaking to you guys. How are you guys going to come with that money to give to me? Now hold on. I got some more of this book right here, Bill of Rights, Constitution 1976. Where it's from, it says many things in there. Now, I'm going to go with the most recent experience. You guys don't know who I am, but in March of 2013, an officer of the law who was a lying thief, the Bible says rebuke, and I was speaking to him over the phone, and I called him a dirty name. A fag. Some police don't like to be called that word. Anyways, so this officer threatened to shoot me in the head. He said, I know Hayport better than everyone. I've hunted there since I was a little kid, and I know it better than everyone, and I'm going to find you, and I'm going to shoot you in the head. He told me he's going to shoot me in the head like 20 or 30 times. And the next morning, he calls the school board up and tells the school board, I guess because he's a cop, that he's trustworthy, that I have a bunch of machine guns, and I'm going to go and shoot and kill every single child at both the high school.
Do you have a question?
Oh, yes, I do. I'll get to it. This is life or death. This is life or death. Let me finish here. Okay? And